Tonight we're coming to Narcissistic Personality Disorder. And if you've ever been in a relationship with an addict, either you or them are probably suffering from Narcissistic Personality Disorder. And maybe you brought them with you tonight just so they could listen and you could elbow them as I talk. I would say, and I gotta be careful here, I would say that probably a third of the people I work with would be diagnosed with narcissistic personality disorder, but a lot of them don't know even what it is. So I want to try to explain it to you and understand up front that we might laugh about it, but we're not making fun of you or putting you down. We're just realizing we're an odd bunch and we got a lot of issues. And most of those issues come out of complex trauma. And what I hope to show you is that narcissistic personality disorder comes out of extreme complex trauma. And so it's the brain's way of trying to cope and deal with the issues around severe complex trauma. And so I hope by putting it in that context, it will take some of the stigma out of it, because it's your brain just trying to survive. And I hope it'll be helpful. I hope you'll see the damage it can do to you and to those around you, and that it will start you on a path of growth and change. So in case you don't know what narcissistic personality disorder is, it comes out of a Greek myth, which is about a man named Narcissus. I think I said that right. Narcissus. And what you have to remember is that back then they did not have mirrors. So you couldn't look at yourself every day as you combed your hair and put on your makeup. And so you really didn't have a very good picture of what you looked like. And so the myth goes that one day Narcissus went to a pond that was perfectly calm, and he bent down to get a drink of water, and he saw his reflection in the water. And he said, "That is one good looking dude." And he came back every day to just admire himself in the water. And so narcissism is a person who's preoccupied with how wonderful they are, and they want everybody to know it. And so that is narcissism. But what I want you to understand is it is very subtle, or it can be very in your face. And so some of you might not see the in your face stuff, but you might see some of the subtle stuff. The second thing I want you to see is this. Many people with NPD, or Narcissistic Personality Disorder, they can be very charming, wonderful people. You don't see their narcissism until they get triggered. And I'll talk about the triggers later, but once they get triggered, their narcissism comes out like it's a different personality. And it is not the prettiest thing in the world. But there are things that a person who really understands it can see when a person's not triggered. So there will be traits that will characterize them when they're not triggered. And so that's what I want to start with, okay? So the first one is that in their own mind, they have this feeling, what we call grandiosity. It can be a fantasy, okay? So they can think they are the greatest person in the world, that if everybody got to know them, they'd fall in love with them, and they can spend lots of time in their brain rehearsing their self-importance, okay? Some, though, let it slip out into their actions, and they act like they are the Queen of England. And they walk around with that pompous grandiosity, like you should bow down and worship at my feet, okay? So some of you probably know people like that, but some of you might just have that fantasy part. Where it comes out is that when they meet people, they tend to believe that those people see them as very important in their life. And so what I have said in the past is this. If a person has narcissistic personality disorder, and a real good girl walks in and they say hi to her, never met her before in their life, and she says hi back, they go, she's in love with me. She thinks I am the greatest, handsomest person in the world. That's where their brain goes. But then they think, not necessarily romantic, but they meet somebody and help them a little bit. And then in their mind, what they begin to think is that person thinks I've been the most helpful person in their life. That person will now see me as being the person that helped them turn the corner and make their life better. I am the main ingredient of their success and their progress. And so they look at themselves that way. Then they can go in their mind to this kind of unlimited success, unlimited power, unlimited popularity that they play out. So that is kind of the first piece of this narcissistic personality. Now let me take you how that can work out in some of the subtle ways. If you were to confront a narcissist about their behavior, they would not own it. What they would probably say is, you don't understand me. Only special people get me. And who do they include in special people? People that think they're wonderful. Anybody else isn't special, and they don't get them, so they don't have to listen to a word they say. I remember confronting someone at Tamarack once who was a narcissist. And everybody saw what they were doing and how sick it was, and I confronted them, and they said with this sadness in their voice, it's too bad you don't understand me. And I thought, okay, but that's what they do. Okay, then what you'll see the next part is they put a ton of energy into image management. In other words, they want to control what you think about them. They want to control your opinion of them. So if somebody says something negative about them, they put tons of energy into changing your opinion of them. And anybody that's heard or read what that person said about you, they run around trying to clear it up so you will get the right opinion of them. So it is a huge concern that you think correctly about them. The next thing they do is they'll make a point of hanging around with influential people. So they want to have in their peer group their close friends, as they would describe it, very powerful, successful people, so that it makes them look good. So that's part of their image management. And then they always are wanting to be admired. And so they work very hard to be validated, noticed, applauded. They go fishing for compliments, all of that kind of stuff. They need admiration, and they will constantly work at getting that, even if they gotta exaggerate their successes. Even if they don't have any successes, they will make them up so that they will get admiration. And then with that, they might walk around and give the impression that they're superior to everybody, especially you. And that is, their hope is that you will see them as superior and then treat them as superior, and speak to them as superior. To them, that's admiration. To them, that's respect. And so that is their focus. And then they have in their mind that everybody's envious of them. That everybody wishes they could be like them. So here's what I want you to understand, and I think you see it. They spend a lot of time distorting reality. And they will even go to acting like a snob, being patronizing, to give the air or the impression of their greatness. Now here's what's really going on. I said that narcissistic personality disorder comes out of severe complex trauma. And what happens in severe complex trauma is you get severe abuse, severe abandonment, severe neglect, and therefore you get severe shame, which says, I am less than nothing. I am unlovable. I am not good enough. They get shame in such a large dose that they can't face it. It's too painful to look at. And so what their brain has to do is deny how they really feel about themselves and then try to compensate for the shame by acting better than everybody. So instead of walking around and honestly saying, I hate myself, I don't feel lovable, I don't feel valuable, they walk around saying, everybody loves me, I am more valuable than everybody, and they distort everything. So there's constant mental gymnastics, but it goes further than that. They even deny that they have any shame. They deny it to themselves, not just to others. And they tell themselves the lie that they are superior to others, and part of them tries hard to believe it, but at a deep, deep level that is cut off from themselves, they still feel the shame. They just will never get honest about that. So that is narcissism. It is a severe, extreme compensation for severe shame. And that you need to understand. The second thing that then comes out of that shame is this. Nobody will love me for me. Nobody will want to meet my needs for me. So the only way I'm going to get love, the only way I'm going to get my needs met, is through manipulating everybody. And so a narcissist is an expert manipulator. They do not know how to love people, they only know how to use people. Now you need to understand something here. They can act like the most loving people in the world, but it's just to use you. So they don't love with no strings attached. They love to get something. They show love with a bad motive, a self-serving motive. And so a narcissist is all about manipulation. When they meet you, they're casing you. And they are learning what your needs are, and then they will learn how to use your needs to get what they want. And they will give you what you think you need, so they will get what they want. So it's all about a hidden agenda. It's all about studying people so you can manipulate them. And therefore, they can come across as some of the nicest people in the world until they got you. And then they change. And so, with that then, a narcissist needs to feel in control. Because it's only when they're in control that they can get what they want. So manipulation and control are their main ways of coping, their main ways of relating. But if they don't get what they want, they get triggered. Now let me talk about their triggers. There's really four main things that trigger a narcissist. Number one, they're super nice to you and you reject them. Or you're super nice to you and you set a boundary with them, which to them feels like rejection. And they can't stand rejection because you're saying they're not good enough. And that will trigger them big time. Secondly, if they manipulate but don't get what they want, they will get triggered. Or if you aren't giving them enough admiration, if you're not giving them enough attention, they will get triggered. Or if you do anything that makes them look bad. You notice that all of those deal with their shame. All of those deal with their lie distortion of who they are being exposed. And if they are triggered, this monster comes out. So do you realize that most abusive people are narcissists? They're nice until they don't get what they want. And then the abuse comes out. Some, it comes out in very angry, physical, verbal abuse. Some narcissists are too good for that. It comes out in the sneakiest, hurtful stuff that you can imagine. And they are like a cat with a mouse. They will just play with you and torture you and drive you crazy. And they will do it without a conscience at all. They will feel guilty because they're not getting what they want, and you made them look bad or all those triggers, and this angry person comes out with zero conscience. Now there's another characteristic of narcissists. Do you realize that many narcissists don't do well in recovery? Here's why. They think they can avoid the consequences of their behavior. They think if they do something like use, that they can con somebody to take the consequences away. They think they're smart enough that they can trick somebody or play somebody and make the consequences disappear. Now the sad part is, that has worked for them many times. And as a result of that, they still think they can keep on doing it. And many narcissists have or keep going to people who will bail them out, that they can manipulate, and they will never stay clean because they always think they can wiggle out of consequences. There's another characteristic of a narcissist, and there's a lack of empathy. And again, I have to say this, they can act very empathetic, but there's always a hidden agenda. Deep down, they don't really care about anybody except themselves. And then, this is one that many of you have experienced. A narcissist can never be wrong. If they are wrong, they will find somebody to blame, so it's never their fault. If you're in a relationship with them, they will twist everything and make you the bad guy. They will never be the bad guy. Why? Because if they're wrong, that exposes their shame. And they can't go there. So they will twist. They will come up with the bizarrest arguments in the world. They will blame everything, especially you. But they will never own their stuff. So that's the narcissistic personality disorder. Don't know if any of you felt that you qualified for that, but I think some of you probably did. Now I thought I would add a second one that kind of takes narcissistic to a new level, a little different place. It's still got narcissism as part of it, but now it brings an emotional part. So it's called histrionic personality disorder. If you're not familiar with the word histrionic, it is a person who is overdramatic. So there's a bug on the windshield and you think they ran over somebody on the street. It's a big production. That's a histrionic person. Okay? So some of you are going to smile when I start explaining this because you know some histrionic personality people. So there's a couple main characteristics. Number one, they are constantly seeking the spotlight. They want attention. And so they go into a room and they think of ways to get everybody to notice them. Okay, so that's number one. They want to be the center of attention, and when they're not happy. So what they might do is they might make a big bunch of noise, they might create a crisis, or they might pout until somebody pays them attention. Or they might give you the silent treatment. But they're working you so they'll get attention, okay? And so if you're talking to them, and you turn to talk to somebody else, they'll follow you and try to bring you back into looking at them. They're seeking out, you have to give me your whole attention and nobody else. So guess what happens if you're dating one of these ones? You can't talk to anybody else in the world. You've got to be only them. Okay? Second thing is this emotional, dramatic stuff. So when they tell you a story, they don't tell you the facts of this story. They sensationalize every detail. Like this is the most exciting thing that's ever happened in the world. They exaggerate most of the details and make up a few, but it's got to be a dramatic story. And then people that get to know them go, they are shallow. They just are emotions and drama. And then the other part of their emotional world is huge mood swings. Overly dramatic to overly angry to overly pouty, all of that kind of stuff. Is their emotional world is 0 to 100 in all kinds of different directions. The next thing, as you can imagine, is they get bored easily. So they need drama to make life exciting. So a routine and structure in their mind is boring. So they crave novelty. They crave stimulation and excitement. And then the next part with them is they need instant gratification. You tell them they gotta wait for a week, they don't like that. They want excitement and they want it now. And so their life is about instant gratification. And any routine, boring, need drama to get gratification. And that becomes kind of the cycle of their life. Now take that into relationships. It shouldn't be hard to imagine that they have difficulty achieving emotional intimacy in a relationship because their emotions are just so surface and so dramatic, they don't really understand healthy intimacy. In their mind, intimacy means intensity. So let's keep the relationship intense. Then we're having a good relationship. Okay? Then, many people with histrionic personality disorder are very flirtatious in their interaction with others. So they use a lot of inappropriate, sexual, seductive type behavior that's designed to kind of flaunt their body, flaunt their good looks, whatever, and to get people to notice them. And so they can be that person that they walk in the room, and if it's a girl, all the other girls go, oh no, they're here, and they're gonna go flounce around and sashay and get everybody to notice them, okay? Then, they consider intimate relationships to be more intimate than they really are. And so they say, oh, we have a real good intimate relationship, but it's really just intensity. So they don't read very well the health of their relationships in an intimate way. Often, to get attention, they will do one of two things. They will rescue everybody, or they will be a needy, needy victim, or they will be a princess that just flounces around. And so they have to take kind of extreme roles in order to function. So extreme victim neediness or extreme princess hero help everybody. And that is how it works out. Then once they get in a relationship, they use emotions to manipulate their partner. And they play on their partner's emotions. They use their own emotions, pouting, silent treatment, anger, all of that. They use seductiveness at one minute and cut you off the next. Always manipulating. One day super needy, super dependent. Other day, don't need you, get out of here. Mixed messages. Push, pull. All that kind of stuff characterizes them. And then guess what happens if it's a healthy, intimate relationship? They get bored. And they go, I need a flame. And so people with histrionic personality disorder and narcissistic personality disorder both are very prone to affairs. Because they need that intensity and that admiration. So once a relationship settles into a routine, they get bored and they start looking elsewhere. Okay, next. Even their friends get a little tired of them and begin to find them a bit of a nuisance to have around too much for two reasons. Number one, they're always trying to be the center of attention, always trying to manipulate their friends to give them more attention. Become depressed when they don't get attention, and it's always something dramatic is going on, and they wear their friends out. Or they're always talking sexual stuff, trying to impress their friends with that, and their friends just get tired of it. And so gradually they begin to lose some of their friends because of that. So if you take narcissistic personality disorder and histrionic personality disorder, I think you can see that they don't do relationships well. And they can cause a lot of damage. And like I said, they tend to become abusive and very manipulative. And they are the ones who will gaslight the people they're with and make them think they're the crazy one and they're the one with all the problems. And it can do a tremendous amount of damage to the other person's self-image. And they can soon start believing the lies that this person says when they twist everything and turn it back on them and make them the bad guy. They start believing it, and that tears down their self-image. But it is one deep, now we're getting to the personality disorders that are really, really hard to heal. Because the shame is so deep, guess what the fear is? If I get honest about how I really feel about myself, it might be true. I might be a nobody. I might be unlovable. I'm afraid to go there. I'm afraid to even consider it. So let's just continue manipulating people and living the way we have. At least we get a little bit of attention. It's not very satisfying after a while, but the alternative feels like death. So let me say this. I have seen people with narcissistic personality disorder start to get healthy. Do you want to know what it usually takes? Addiction. Why is it addiction? Because everything they do doesn't work. And they keep failing, and it gets worse and worse until they have no option but to say, I'm a screw-up. And they're forced to start getting honest And it's a scary, scary journey. But for those that do it, I've seen beautiful growth begin to happen. Now, they can still get triggered and go backwards in a heartbeat. But the growth can happen. But you have to begin with getting honest with yourself about how you really deep down feel. Let me end with this. I met today with a 15-year-old boy. His mom's an addict. His grandma's an addict. He was raised, abandoned by mom and dad. Dad in prison. And he came to see me. And he said, I'm really struggling with, you'll know it, depression and anxiety. So I said, let me see if I can help you understand why you're struggling with that. I said, you're 15. I bet you're starting to wonder why your mom chose drugs over you, why your dad chose crying over you. And he said, yeah, I've been wondering that. I says, how does it make you feel when you wonder that? I don't feel very good. I feel a lot of pain. I said, yes, that's exactly right. But you want to know the beauty to me was? At 15, he was able to be honest. It hurt him. You could see the pain in his eyes. But the fact that he got honest, in my mind, okay, there's hope for this kid. He's got some tough decisions ahead of him. But he's starting on the right first step of getting honest. And so if you struggle with either narcissistic personality disorder or histrionic, I hope you can at least feel safe enough with somebody to get honest.